Now let's see about the allocation of frames. CPU can execute a process if it resides in main memory only. Generally, the main memory is divided into a number of equal size partitions called frames. So operating system can allocate frames to the process using five approaches. Why? Because CPU can execute a process if it resides in main memory only. So operating system has to store the process in the main memory. So operating system has to allocate a sufficient number of frames for the corresponding process. So in order to allocate frames for the process, we use five approaches. First approach, equal allocation. Second approach, proportional allocation. Third approach, priority allocation. Fourth approach, global replacement allocation. Fifth approach, local replacement allocation. So let's see the first one, equal allocation. The name itself specifies the meaning. In equal allocation, the frames will be allocated equally among available processes. So let we have two processes. First process P1, second process P2. Let us assume that P1 requires 10 frames for its execution. Likewise, P2 requires 30 frames for its execution. So process P1 requires 10 frames. Process P2 requires 30 frames. The size of the main memory is 40 frames. Let main memory size is 40 frames. So let in main memory we have 40 frames. Then in equal allocation what we have in is the 40 frames will be distributed equally between the processes P1 and P2. So 40 by 2 means 20. So 20 frames will be allocated for process P1 and 20 frames will be allocated for process P2. So actually process P1 requires only 10 frames. But how many frames are allocated for process P1? 20 frames. So that means 10 frames of the memory is wasted. Next, process P2 actually requires 30 frames. But how many frames are allocated here? Only 20 frames are allocated. So it requires 10 more frames for its execution. So here the major disadvantage of this problem is actually process P1 requires only 10 frames. But 20 frames are allocated for process P1. So that means we are unnecessarily wasting 10 frames of the memory. So this is the problem here. So there is a wastage of 10 frames. We can overcome this problem with the help of the second approach. The second approach is proportional allocation. So proportional allocation means the frames will be allocated based upon the size of the process. So according to the size of the process, the available frames will be allocated. Here also let us assume that process P1 requires 10 frames, process P2 requires 30 frames and the size of the main memory is 40 frames. So that means 40 frames are available for storing P1 and P2. Then how much frames does process P1 will get is, simply we have to calculate the ratio here. So process P1 requires how many frames? 10 frames. So 10 by, what is the demand of process P1 and process P2? Process P1 requires 10 frames. So P2 requires 30 frames. So 10 plus 30. So 10 plus 30 frames are required into. So main memory totally contains how many free frames? 40 frames. So this is nothing but 10 by. So 10 plus 30 means what? 40 into 40. So 40. So what will happen? 10 frames. So for process P1, how many frames will be allocated? 10 frames will be allocated for process P1. So in the similar way, we have to calculate for process P2 also. So here process P2 will get how many frames? So process P2 actually requires 30 frames. So simply calculate the ratio, 30 by. Next, process P1 requires 10 frames. So 10 plus. Process P2 requires 30 frames. So 10 plus 30 into. So total free frames in the main memory 40. So that is equal to 30 by. So 10 plus 30 means 40. So into 40. So 40. So 30. So 30 frames will be allocated for process P2. So actually what is the demand of process P1? 10 frames. So only 10 frames are allocated for process P1. Next, process P2 requires how many frames? 30 frames. So only 30 frames are allocated for process P2. So that is the major advantage here. Here we are not wasting any frames here. Process P1 requires only 10 frames. So 10 are allocated. Process P2 requires only 30 frames. So only 30 frames are allocated. So this is the advantage of the proportional allocation. So according to the size, the frames will be allocated to the process. But here the problem is the priority won't be considered here. So here it doesn't show any difference between high priority process and low priority process. So actually, if it is a high priority process, then operating system has to allocate more frames for high priority process. Why? Because operating system has to execute high priority process first. So if it is a low priority process, then low priority process needs to be executed next after executing the high priority process. So this is the major problem with priority allocation. This is the major problem with proportional allocation. Proportional allocation doesn't distinguish between high priority and low priority. It allocates the frames depending upon the size of the process. So it doesn't allocate based upon the priorities. So we can overcome that problem with the help of the third approach. That is nothing but priority allocation. So the name itself specifies the meaning. So based upon the priority, the frames will be allocated to the process. So the process which is having higher priority will be allocated more number of frames. Likewise, the process which is having low priority will be allocated less number of frames. Or the frames will be allocated based upon the priority and the size. So the process which is having high priority as well as the process which requires more number of frames will be allocated more number of frames. Likewise, the process with low priority and the process which requires less number of frames will be allocated less number of frames. So based upon the priority, the frames will be allocated, or based on the combination of priority and size also, the allocation will be done here. So this is about priority allocation. Now let's see about global replacement allocation and local replacement allocation. So this is mainly useful while performing the replacement. So we know what is replacement. Whenever CPU needs to execute a page, then it checks whether that page is present in main memory or not. If the corresponding page is present in the main memory, then CPU executes that page. Suppose if the page is not present in the main memory, then it is called as a page fault. So whenever a page fault occurs, then operating system loads that page from secondary memory to the primary memory, but assumes that main memory is completely full. Then we have to replace one of the pages in the main memory in order to store the new page from the secondary memory. So which page we have to replace? So that should be done with the help of various replacement algorithms like FIFO, OPT, LRU. So all those algorithms comes under either global replacement allocation or local replacement allocation. First, let's see what is a global replacement allocation. Here, global allocation allows a process to select a frame from the list of all the frames. So even though that frame is allocated to some other process. So let's take an example here. So let we have two processes. So this is nothing but process P1. Let process P1 is stored in some five frames. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 frames. So this is process P2. Let process P2 is stored in 3 frames. So here we have 5 frames. So 5 frames are allocated for process P1. Next here we have 3 frames. So 3 frames are allocated for process P2. So this is nothing but our main memory. So whenever we use global allocation, then global allocation allows a process to select a frame from list of all the frames, even though that frame is allocated to some other process. That means if we use global replacement allocation, then process P1 can take a frame from process P2. Likewise, process P2 can take a frame from process P1. So let us assume that CPU is executing process P1. And here a page fault occurs, so that operating system loads a page from secondary memory to the main memory. So which page we have to replace? Let us assume that here we use global allocation. So in global allocation, what will happen? We can store one process page in another process frame also. That means process P1 page can be stored here also, in process P2 also. Likewise, when executing process P2, an interrupt occurs, then if you use global replacement allocation, then we can store process P2 page in any of the frames. So we can store process P2 page in process P1 frame also. So that is nothing but global replacement allocation. So let we have some high priority process and low priority process.
So a high priority process can take a frame from a low priority process. So then what will happen? The number of frames for higher priority process will be increased, whereas the number of frames for lower priority process will be decreased. So the number of pace faults for high priority process will be decreases. Why? Because here a high priority process called P1 is getting frames from low priority process called P2. So more number of frames will be allocated for P1. So if there are more number of frames for process P1, then automatically the pace fault rate will be decreases. But here the problem with global replacement allocation is, here the pacing behavior of one process can depends upon the pacing behavior of another process. Why? Because here the pace faults of one process depends upon the pace faults of another process. Why? Because here we are storing one process pace in another process frame. We are storing process P1 pace in process P2 pace or process P1 pace also. Suppose if process P1 pace is stored in process P2 frame, then let us assume that it is a lower priority process. So because of this lower priority pace, then process P1 pace fault rate may be increases. So that is the problem here. Okay, the pacing behavior of one process depends upon the pacing behavior of another process. Why? Because we can store one process pace in another process. Now let's see about local replacement allocation. Local allocation allows a process to select a frame from its own allocated frames. That means, let us assume that CPU is executing process P1. Then we have to store process P1 pace only in the allocated frames. So how many frames are allocated for process P1? So 5 frames. So in those 5 frames only, the corresponding process P1 pace will be stored. Likewise, let us assume that CPU is executing process P2 pace, process P2. Then what will happen? Whenever a replacement is needed, then we have to store process P2 pace only in the allocated frames of process P2. That means one of these pages, one of these 3 pages will be replaced. So that is the difference here. So that means here one process can't take frame from other process. So that means the number of frames allocated to a process can't change. So if 3 frames are allocated for process P2, then in these 3 frames only the process P2 information can be stored. So we can say that the pacing behavior of one process can't depends upon the other process. Why? Because process P2 pace is not stored in process P1. Okay. So among global replacement allocation and local replacement allocation, global replacement allocation is the best one. It produces better throughput, better output than local replacement allocation. Why? Because in global replacement allocation, what will happen? We can store one process pace in another process. So what will happen? The number of frames allocated for a process will be increases. So high priority process can take a frame from lower priority process. So high priority process will get more number of frames. So if high priority process gets more number of frames, then automatically the number of pace faults will be decreases. So we can say that global replacement allocation produces better throughput, better output than local replacement allocation. So this is about allocating frames to the process.